Well, praise the Lord, here we are Friday night, and you know, it's awesome that we are at that point where we can have a service Thursday and Friday nights. The Lord is definitely blessing and opening up a lot of doors for us. And so it's encouraging, and it's encouraging when we have a brother that will come on and share his testimony, and you know, we've heard a lot of testimony. Rhonda, I really believe that basically we all have the same testimony. We're all born in sin. We're all liars, thieves, adulterers, murderers, gossipers, you know, the whole nine yards. But it's Jesus' testimony that gets us excited. And that's the testimony of how he transforms people and how he delivers them from their past, washes them in the blood, stands them up, and, you know, puts them in the ministry. And that's what we get excited about. And from talking with you, I know that that's what he has done with you. So I would like to welcome each and every one that is called in through the Lord's round table. And I'd like to welcome all those that are listening through internet radio. No matter what part of the world you find yourself in right now, you are welcome to be here with us. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Steve, and I'm the doorman of the Lord's round table. It's a great honor and privilege for me to be able to hold the door and welcome you all in. So with that being said, Brother Roger, I'm just going to, I'm not going to do an introduction of, who you are, your attributes, or anything like that. They all know now that your name's Roger. I'm just going to let you do all that. So with that being said, it's all yours.
All right. Well, I think it's a real pleasure to be able to be with you and be with the many people who are tuning in at this time. This is about the Lord's glory, and that's what we want, is to see his glory written upon high. Because as we exalt him, then he also exalts us in his glory, and that's what we're about. We want to see the Father glorified. My name is Roger Cook. I have a very unique and very powerful testimony. I've been through a lot in my 62 years of living. I started out in kind of the Midwest, Iowa, Minnesota, Northern Illinois, as a young child. I lived in my first 8 years with my aunts and grandmas. My dad was in the military. When they got in the military, he pretty much was out doing this thing like a lot of fathers do today. They didn't have much care for the fact that they had a son or a daughter or children living somewhere else. When, over a series of events, I ended up going out to live with him. First in the east side of Chicago, Gary, during the end of the was about 8 or 9 years old. He had remarried, and I came in kind of as the black sheep of this new relationship with him and my stepmother. It was very difficult for me trying to understand how to fit in. They had my first half-brother just shortly after they married, and then another one about 2 years later. And I always found myself kind of on the outside of the family. My dad was not, my family has not really been what we would call a loving family. They were hard workers, they were Midwestern, hard-working people. My boys had food and shelter and holes in the back, but they did not exhibit a lot of love. In fact, I found quite a bit of abuse from my dad when I got over it. Partly because I was rebellious, because I couldn't understand how to be accepted, so I rebelled. Typical of a lot of testimonies and people I know even today. But eventually, trying to fit in, I did a lot of sports when I was younger, wrestling, every time I was in grade school through high school, some basketball, swimming, et cetera, et cetera. But I drifted into the drug scene back in the 70s, and I found that the hippies, as you might say, were pretty accepting of people. I didn't have a lot of rejection from that group of people, so I found myself being able to fit in. When my dad was moving to Florida, he left me the house when I was about 17, 18 years old, and of course, as a young teenager, I went to town with it, doing drugs and partying. have sex with women in social club. Eventually, I remember having my son's mother. We lived together for about 3 years. My son was born when I was 19. He was a great surprise, a great kid, Demetrius. We tried to make it work, but you know, when you're doing drugs and drinking and just not living the right life that God ordained it for this to be, and living in sin, of course the relationship didn't work and we ended up breaking up. I was working construction and working as a friend and stuff. I would go pick my son up on the weekends and keep him for the weekends. Well, I went over one weekend and she wasn't there nor my son living with her father. And I said, "Where's that? Where's that?" Well, she was a topless dancer. I've been around him throughout my younger years. And he told me he didn't know. So I told him, "I'll be back next weekend. Please find out where my son's at and I'll come pick him up." I came back the next weekend and he didn't know that. And I found out about a month later from a family friend that she'd given him up for illegal adoption. And that really set me in a very bad course of my life. When I lost my son, I thought I lost all respect for myself. My trajectory in life went downward very quickly. I went from doing drugs to a heavy drug dealer. So much so I got involved with organized crime out of California, here in Colorado. And I was pumping drugs into the Colorado Springs and Denver area at a pretty hefty rate. Well, about a year into that, I didn't quite a year, probably about 7 months, I guess, a friend of mine who was working with me in the drug world came across a bad drug deal. A couple of people began to threaten him, his family threatened the drug business. We tried to, in my disorganized and sinful way, tried to stop it from happening a couple of times, but it blew out of proportion with the result of me being responsible for the murder of one person and there when another person was murdered simultaneously in a drug-related crime. So about 3 months later, not wasn't that. Where was it? I see that happened September, it was in April, probably 7 months later. I was arrested. Myself, the other people that were involved, we were all arrested simultaneously. And that was in 1981, about April of 1981. They charged me with two counts of first degree murder, second degree kidnapping, conspiracy to commit murder, and were seeking the death penalty against me and against the rest of the people that were involved. I had some encounters with Christians before I had gotten heavy into drugs. There had been some seed planted in my life. And you know, when you plant a seed in the ground, it doesn't come forth right away. That seed has to die and then be watered the right season, and that seed will produce the fruit of it later on. While I was in the county jail, awaiting my trial, shortly after I went to the county jail, that's when I come across a jailhouse minister, a chaplain, who talked with me, and in his service, I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior in about probably May or June, somewhere in 1981. About 3 months later, I spent a lot of time after that just studying the Word, praying, even began fasting. Didn't know it, but I swear God said in His Word to do it. I was young. I was hungry for the things of God. He did a miraculous work in me. I was set free from drugs right away. The desire for drugs was completely taken away from me. That was a true miraculous deliverance when I got saved. The other struggles I had with anger and lust and such like that, those were long-term battles that I had to deal with. I think everybody can relate to those things. Sometimes we can get set free from them right away, and other ones may take a long time for us to really conquer. So a few months later, I got a friend of mine who was a minister from the Assembly of God's come up, and we were doing Bible studies. I really felt I was missing something from the Lord. And I told him, I said, "I don't know what it as I said, but I feel like I'm missing something. And I said, would you mind coming see me? And he said, sure. And he had an appointment to come see me in training room in County Jail, in El Paso County, Colorado Springs. He sat with me and talked to me about the baptism of the Spirit, speaking in tongues and everything that the Pentecostals and church call. And when I walked out of the room, I was speaking in tongues and baptizing the radiance of God in such a powerful, powerful way. When I walked back into the unit, there were men sitting there gambling and playing cards. And I walked in and I heard someone cussing. And it felt like a spear had gone through my eardrum. It hurt. That's how radical God changed me. I mean, the power of the Holy Spirit was powerful within me. From that time on until I was sentenced in June, or July, I should say, of 1982, I began to minister to men in the county jail. Many men were healed. Many men were saved. Filled with the Spirit. Seen many turnarounds in different people's cases. And it was just the beginning of the call in my life that I didn't understand. I just enjoyed sharing Jesus with other people. It was in my heart to tell people with the grace of God. When I was convicted, I was given a double life sentence, not a single life sentence. They did not convict me of the death penalty. I was given the double life sentence. So it was two life sentences. They were 20 years apiece. They could run them consecutively to be 40 years. So in July 2nd of 1982, I was taken from the courtroom and had been sentenced to two consecutive life sentences of 40 years maximum, straight into the Colorado Department of Corrections, into the Stillhouse 5. It was such a radical change to anything I had ever thought or experienced in my life. In 1982, it was in December of 1980, they had just opened up the maximum security unit. It was a brand new facility. I went straight to maximum security because of my sentence, because it was a long sentence and because of the crime. And I got stuck in maximum security unit with most of the men who were all long-term lifers or long-term sentences. And many of them had been already in prison for 10 and 15 years or more. And to say the least, my first 4 to 5 years of my Christian walk was hell. I was the only Christian in the maximum security unit. There were no other Christians there. I was still serving the Lord, but I was still in such a place that was such violence, such manipulations and things going on. I saw several murders. I had well, rapes that took place, stabbings and fights. In fact, myself within about the first year and a half or 2 years of my imprisonment, I myself was assaulted and raped. I didn't understand how God was working in my life, how he could allow such a thing to happen. I felt my life was on the line. I was scared, even though I was a fighter. I fought all my life. I had been involved with martial arts, taekwondo, aikido, boxing, wrestling. But I didn't know how to now walk out a Christian walk without violence. I didn't know that I could stand up for myself as a man and be manly and not have to be abused by people. So when that happened, it really shook me. It shook my faith. It shook my person. I couldn't understand where was God at when this was happening. Why would this happen to me? And I didn't understand until many, many, many decades later. Some things that I think all of us can relate to as sinners. I use it as an analogy to teach you some things. Coal. Coal is put together by dead things in the ground. Dead plants, dead animals put under pressure. And that's where coal, from my understanding, comes from. Well, all all of us before we were accepting Christ, before we were saved, are pieces of coal. We're meant to be put in the fire and destroyed. But when coal comes under the right pressures and the right heat, what comes out of coal are diamonds. Diamonds in the rough. And when you are saved, you and I are diamonds in the rough. And now God puts us in the hands of people and circumstances that begins to cut the facets of that diamond in place so we can reflect His glory. And I showed this recently when I was meeting some people. I said, when you go to a high-end jewelry store to look at diamonds, I said, what is the background of the diamonds? And they thought about it, and someone said, well, it's a black background, usually black velvet. I said, absolutely. I said, why is that? And they said, well, the black absorbs the light while the diamond reflects the light. And I said, where's the light usually at? And they said, well, above it. I said, can you see our analogy as Christians? We are set in the backdrop of a black, darkened, and dead world in sin. But we are the faceted diamonds of God to reflect His glory from above. And that's what I began to do for the next 40 years in prison. I got out last year in March 22nd, I believe it was, of 2020. And I had spent approximately 31 straight years in prison. I've been out now for a little over a year. And I know God is a God of timing, a God of numbers. So I began to reflect what it was He was doing. And I had many times when I was in prison, I asked Him, why so long? Because I saw other men who had done crimes similar to mine, or even worse, and were getting out of prison. And I didn't quite understand it all. It took many decades for me to begin to understand it. But I'll digress and then go back to my time in prison. I left maximum security unit and went to another unit in 1986, where I was being baptized in water by a chaplain. And began to be able to serve Christ in a much more open way. And I realized, too, after the assault on my life, and many threats against my life, because about 2 years within my prison sentence, after I saw everything that was going on, I realized I'm not going to allow myself to be conformed to the prison system. I just refuse it, just like we are not to allow ourselves to be conformed to the world. The Bible says that clearly we are to present ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is our reasonable service, and not to be conformed to this world, this standard of living, this age of living, but be transformed, metamorphosed, by the renewing of our mind. Same thing as a butterfly coming out of a caterpillar, crawling around, going into a cocoon, and becoming a butterfly, flying freely from flower to flower, sucking up the sweetness of that flower. That's our lives. And that was my life. I left this living while I was baptized in water baptized, and went to a brand new facility called Arkansas Valley. I spent 10 years there. I went there in 1987. And in 1992, I and a couple other men began an in-prison ministry where we began to have Bible studies. We started a new yard, and we had favor, remarkable favor. There was a few empty rooms there that would be adjacent to the yard, and I was able to get one of the rooms, because I worked in the gym, I was able to get one of the rooms. And we began to have Bible studies. Now, this one may sound radical, but we were a pretty radical group of men. Black, white, Hispanic. There was no distinction in relation to their culture. We came together for the purpose of studying and knowing God. For the next 5 years, we were together every single day in the Word. That's on top of working a job, working out, and doing things. We would get together anywhere from 1 hour to 3 hours, and sometimes longer if we could, up to 5 hours a day, every day, for five straight years, except if there was a lockdown or a shakedown going on. We were together, and the group grew from a few handful of men all the way up to 15 and 20 men. And I cannot tell you probably the hundreds of men that passed through and stopped by. Many of them who I know today said that their foundation in Christ and their walk in Christ was set in that prison environment. They are now out serving Christ, being successful because of that. Many of them are my friends. Many of them are successful husbands and businessmen. It was from there, there was a man who came into my life. He was the one who helped start the work. His name was Eddie. And he had told me, he said, you're called to be a pastor. And I scoffed at him. I said, no way. I said, I'm not a pastor. Although I love teaching the word, I love the Lord. He says, no, they call me a pastor. And I says, no. And he says, why? And I don't mean to offend anybody who might be listening. But I said, well, I envision the pastors as just kind of fat little guys who are kind of soft. And I said, that's not me. In fact, after I realized that I don't have to be abused by people, I began to stand up for myself and being a fighter. I had to get a fight a couple of times while I was in prison, and then I realized how skilled I was and how vicious I would fight. People began to realize, what kind of Christian are you? If you're a fighting Christian? I said, yes. I said, you're not going to put your hands on me. And that's going to hurt me. I said, I'm not going to allow you to abuse me. And so I'm going to stand up for myself. God didn't raise us to be cowards. We are to be dynamic, powerful men and women of God. Not have to allow ourselves to be abused in a way that's not Christ-like. Does that mean that you got to allow yourself to lay yourself down for Christ? I absolutely will, and I have done so countless times when I was in prison. Men need to be helped get out of gang affiliations and different things that they got themselves. We would go and we would intervene for them to the point where we would lay our lives down. And I've had countless threats against my life while I was in prison. I mean, literally real countless threats. They had a contract to kill me shortly after I went to prison because I refused to be conformed to the system. That doesn't mean I'm told on people. I just wouldn't join groups or gangs or anything like that. And so they tried to put a contract out to kill me. Of course, God delivered me from such things as that. And I'm still alive today because nobody can die before their time. I believe all of our time is set by God. Every day of our life is written in His book, it says in Psalms 139, before one of them even comes to pass. And I stand on that word, and I believe it is true. We cannot die before we accomplish and finish our purpose here on the earth that God has called us to. So, in 1997, because of prison overcrowding, they sent me to Minnesota for a year, which is back to my home stomping grounds. And maybe where I lived from that time out, I started the ministry in prison. I became well-known in the prison system. I went into the prison system when there was 3,500 people. When I left the prison system, there was 22,000 people. And my reputation as a man of God and the ministry of the gospel preceded me everywhere I went. And God gave me a remarkable favor everywhere I went to begin the prison ministry and begin preaching and teaching the word. Sometimes we do it in inclement weather outside. When I came back to Minnesota, we went to a facility called Crowley. And it was run by CCI, which is a corporation, Corrections Corporation of America, CCA, I should say. We were used to be in the benches, river baseball benches. And outside, and we would have 20, 30 men. They'd get by this open. We'd be out there preaching and teaching the word. And there was even a couple of times the men would go by and literally throw real rocks at us. A couple of the brothers had been hit by rocks, in fact. Remarkably, no one was hurt. And no one got up to get in a fight. That's how much God's grace was upon us. So, in Crowley, the ministry went from 20 to 30 people after being in for about 8 years. It grew into 125 to 150 men per service 3 to 4 times a week. I found myself at times in conflicts with chaplains because they thought I was trying to do their job when I was not. My job was to teach and train the men of God not to conform to the system and to be godly men. But God always opens the door. When we do things the way God intends for us to do, He will always, always open the doors for us. So, I continue throughout all these years, everywhere I go, teaching and preaching the gospel. I've had audiences up to 300 to 400 men at a time. We did food sales. We raised money for the tsunami victims and for the Katrina victims, and we gave it to the Salvation Army and the veterans groups and such like that. Do food sales and different things. And in those years in prison, first few years, we did some pretty radical fasting. We fasted about every weekend for 2 to 3 days at a time. But first, I was scared to death because I was not putting on weight. I was not getting kind of big, lifting weights and stuff, and I was used to being pretty thin and pretty skinny all my life. And now I was getting big, and I thought, man, if I fast, I'm going to lose all this weight. But praise God, I did. In fact, He kept me. And so I made my life a lifestyle of fasting for years, and it broke all kinds of demonic things off my life: anger, lust, fighting. And the anointing of God has poured into my life in such a radical, powerful, powerful way. And I just delved into the things of God. And there'd be times when I would sit in the yard studying the Word and talking with the Lord. He would ask me a question about something. He would literally ask me a question. You'll see he does the same thing in the Bible. So I'm not saying something that's not in the Bible. And I would like, well, what about this? And I would start a discussion with God. What about that? He would lead me in the study to find the answer. And again, that lines up the book of Proverbs in many places, that it is the king's Lord to search out a word or a matter. And we all are kings and priests of the Lord in training. Training for the life to come and the millennial kingdom and we will serve as literal kings and priests of the earth. So, all those years, the Lord, as a father to me that I never had, poured himself into my life. I ministered so many different men and made such good relationships with men. And when they got out, they continued to communicate with me. And when they got out, their families saw their change. And their families got saved. I know of several families who the men got out of it. And when they got out, the families were so touched by them that they too accepted Christ. And they too became my friends. Families to me. My own family had forsaken me because of what I had done and didn't want anything to do with me. In fact, my own dad, when I asked him to come visit me while I was in prison, I told him I graduated from college, I had a couple of college degrees. Different things. When I told him that, he said, I'll talk to you when you get out of prison. And he said, so you're still going to be the same old hard butt you've always been? And he said, yeah. And he said, the truth is, you should be dead and in hell. He says, if I was the family victim who you murdered, I would kill you myself, he said. And I thought, wow. So if anybody's listening and you have had your family truly against you, especially for Jesus, Jesus himself said the family would be our own enemies. And I didn't find that to be so. I tried to witness to them on several occasions about the change of Christ's work in my life, and they did not want to hear it. My family was very irreligious and didn't want to hear anything about it. Unfortunately, both my dad and mother passed away without ever coming to Christ while I was in prison. And so all my family had become spirit family. And I always say that spirit bond is tighter than flesh and blood bond, because the spirit bond is eternal. And the spirit bond has a love with it that's unbreakable. Doesn't mean we're perfect, but there's such a bond of love in the spirit between believers that is so remarkable, so much more richer than anything the flesh and blood can bring. And I did not know that for years, but I began to understand that over time. So sons were being changed, husbands were being changed, brothers and uncles are being changed. Curses on families are being broken. I've seen the whole family line of people to be in prison, from the father, the grandfather, the uncle, the sons, nephews, whole family lines. And I would see family lines being changed and that curse broken because of Jesus Christ. When I lost my son, I'll just back a little bit, negotiate a little bit. He treated me and found me through an organization that finds victims or finds lost family members. And he found me in prison when he was 17 years old and began to write to me. Talked to me about his upbringing with his foster family. It was pretty abusive there, and he started doing drugs. And I thought to myself, something you need to stop. Well, then, I can't remember what year it was, I believe it was 2005 or 4, 5, 6 or whatever. I got word that he went to prison because he was breaking into houses and he was trying to get money to deal with his drug addiction. And that really crushed me because I was the only one in my family who had ever gone to prison. And I thought I had brought a curse on all my family because now my son is in prison. And it took me a while to get over that, but how the outcome of it, he got free from drugs. Because of my reputation, the people who knew me, they kind of took him under their wing and taught him how to do the time, how to stay out of trouble, how to change his life. He has not yet come to Christ, but I'm praying for him. But he got out of prison after about, I think it was 3 or 4 years, and he has never gone back, and he's been successful. So in 2012, I believe it was, he was born in 1977, and he was 35. I had graduated from a group in prison called Nurturing Fathers. We had a facility called Q Carson. And it was about fathering and parenting from prison. And I was asked to join because of the things I had to offer. Upon the graduation, we had a family day at the prison where the family members and the kids could come in, and we did. And they allowed my son and his wife to come in, even though he was on parole. They arranged to the Department of Corrections, through the corporation, CCA, through my case manager, the unit manager, his parole officer, 5 different agencies, provided for him to come down and see me for the first time. In 32 years. He changed his life and mine. So we have been very close since then. Then another blow came to me because his son, my grandson, who lives in Iowa, he went to prison. And I couldn't quite fathom what was going on, but in that process, he accepted Christ. And now he's out, got a brand new baby, which is my granddaughter, great-granddaughter, and is doing very, very well. So for anybody who's listening, God can turn around the curse that's on our families, because he is a God of restoration. He calls us to relationship. He calls us to relationship first with him and with people. That's what he's always wanted. It was never a religion that he came to give. Christ didn't come to bring a religion. He came to reconcile relationship back to the Father by giving his own life. And because of it, we are now in a relationship. It is not a religion. It's not a denomination. In fact, Christianity didn't have a name until centuries later. They were all called followers of the man of the prophet of Nazarene, the Jesus, the Christ, or the followers of the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. It was never called Christianity. So I want you to know God restores and heals. He healed my body of hepatitis C. He healed me many different times. Twice I almost died in prison from various diseases and various sicknesses once I had walked in the morning. And walking in the morning. And another time, I can't remember what it was, but both times I was deadly sick. And both times God raised me up and healed me. So I've seen the power of God when I was in prison, where I watched demons be cast out of people, where bodies were literally, miraculously healed. I saw bones grow in places where there was no bones, and there was x-rays to prove it. I saw deaf ears opened, one eyes literally opened. I watched demons' lives be radically transformed, and staff officers transformed by the power of our risen Christ and our testimony. And that is what my desire is doing, is to just share my testimony of the things that God can do in lives. And I was blessed in those 38, 39 years to come into such a deep relationship with the Lord. I actually began to study the culture of Jesus when he was walking on the earth, and the Middle East culture. And it really set in place how to understand the Bible. The Bible was being written in King James originally. It was written in Hebrew and Greek. It was not written in Europe. It was written in Israel, in the Middle East, which is a culture completely different in Europe or America or any place else. And I began to understand the culture of it, the Bible and the times of Jesus and the prophets and the apostles came alive to me like nobody's business. And they just opened everything up to me. And that happened in about 2002. And from that time forward, God has just been richly pouring more and more into me. I got out, my spiritual son has a ministry called New Hope Ministries in Commerce City here in Colorado. And he would pick me up from the halfway house where I was at, community crutches, and we would go to church. And he had been in prison with me. Almost everybody I know in some form or fashion had been in prison with me. And that's literally now hundreds of men and their families. Hundreds. And I would go to church on the outside, free on the inside first, before I ever got free on the outside. But I was now free out here attending church. And a couple months into that, I asked him one day, I says, when are we going to combine my vision and the anointing of my life, as I believe I'm called, as an apostle, coming up to leaders in the body of Christ, and train them to become pastors and ministers in our own churches. When are we going to combine the two ministries together? He said, I was just waiting for you to ask. And so from about, June or July, somewhere in there, I became the associate pastor of the church in which I'm now attending. Then I didn't have a problem getting a job. God says he supplies all of our need according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And that includes the ability to make money, to make a living. He teaches us this in the way to profit. He teaches us in the way to prosper. And you walk in alignment with God, not just a believer, but you walk in alignment. Like when Jesus said, a Christian is not a person who is only saved, but a person who walks in alignment with God. God needs to walk in the ways of the Lord. When you do that, he just phenomenally, miraculously, overabundantly begins to just open doors of favor for you. While I was in prison, those people who got out of prison began to send me back money. So I went from making maybe 6 cents a day in prison. Having people sending me money. In fact, I became a partner of the prison, the Christian Brother Mountain is in Detroit, Michigan. As a trucking company, began to send me anywhere from $100 to $500 a month. I would give tithes and offerings in that money because I'm a big believer in supporting Christian ministries, and I would tell you to support this ministry that Steve is doing because it's going to touch many people and does. We're sowing in the kingdom of God, and I believe in that. I believe that we're giving our lives back to communities and to the people around us. So in that time from about 2002, 2004, until I got out to 2020, I was able to donate and give away over $25,000 from prison. I still had money saved up for me when I got out. I was able to get a job during COVID with many people that were losing jobs. God provided me with a good job. Unfortunately, the job went out of business, but not too long, and then I got hired at my present job working as a shop manager for Airport College here in Denver. And the man I work for is a great man, a good friend of mine, and nothing but respect for him. And he's given me a new opportunity to start life. And so I try to be a light in a dark place there. And everywhere we go, I believe that we have authority. Everywhere we go, I believe the anointing of God is upon us, and we have authority in that place. Whether you're driving in a truck, whether you're home with your children, whether you're working in a factory, whatever you're doing, you're placed there by God. God gives you authority. And I believe that. And we can be that light in that place. We can change the atmosphere in that place. We can change the dynamic and lives of people in that place. Everybody gets to stand behind the pulpit. And so wherever we're at, we have the ability to dynamically change the atmosphere and the lives of people. And that is my mission in life. And I'm grateful to have this opportunity here. And I got out of prison, to say the least, the world had changed radically. I met a woman who is now my prison wife on the train. I used to take a train, it was a passenger train, from my halfway house all the way across town to a place called Wheatridge. It was quite a long train ride, usually lasted over an hour. And miraculously, we began to just talk on the train and meet. And every time I got out of the car, she happened to be there. Even though there could be 6 or 7 cars. And we just began to talk and began to date. So we would sit and talk. And I would sit sometimes in the union station downtown waiting for the train and look at people. Sitting there eating an ice cream cone or something like that, waiting for the train. Looking at people, watching people. And I saw the devilish abuse of this thing we call a cell phone. It can be used for good or it can be used for evil. But I watched how people, they would walk with their faces in their cell phones. And they didn't even be looking up. And I began to see people talking. I thought they were talking to themselves. And they were actually talking with the earbuds that they had in their ears. I thought, well, how crazy is this? I saw homelessness like I never expected to see. I saw people and see people who were truly by drugs, truly demon-possessed, living on the streets, living crazy, doing many crazy things. I mean, when I got out, the height of COVID was just happening. I came into Denver, and Denver was on a prison lockdown, essentially. Everything was locked down. And yet God walked me through it, provided for me. To say the least, it has been a fast-moving transition. I got married February 13th of this year to Terry, who is my loving, beautiful wife, very supportive, and she's watched me walk through the transition, trying to figure out how to feel about things, how to react to things, but God has kept me. And people's lives continue to be touched and changed out here. So, Steve, I want you to know I am so grateful to be able to share this testimony. I don't want to ramble on too much more. There's so much more I can tell you, but I continue to see lives being changed by this money.
Amen, amen. We know that the Word of God says that by we're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and by our testimonies. And it's through our testimonies that encouragement comes. There's so many people that think that their lives are at the very bottom and they don't see no light. And then when, you know, somebody will come out such as yourself and share your experience and how God had transformed you and raised you up and using you in a more powerful way than what you could imagine, it gives encouragement to, you know, to all those that are listening. You know, when you were saying that your family had basically turned their backs on you, you know, it reminded me of when Jesus was in Capernaum and they came to him and they said, Jesus, your mother and your brother are outside. And he said, who are my mother and who are my brothers but those that seek the kingdom of God? You know, that's the true family, in Jesus Christ. So, you know, I mean, all through your testimony, there was so many scriptures that was coming to mind that just gave confirmation to everything that you were saying. You know, even when you were talking about, and I'm paraphrasing from, you know, the way you had exactly said it, but when you were talking about, you know, the things that we had done, but God uses them. And, you know, we see that in Romans 8:28. You know, take all, you know, to turn them to the good of those who love them and are called according to his purpose. You know, you can witness to somebody effectively that had lived the life that you did better than what I could. I mean, we know when somebody has lived it and when somebody has learned it. Yes, whether it's you buy a book or a movie or, you know, whatever it might be, you know the person that truly lived that life. And so, you know, I really appreciate you coming on here. I really appreciate the openness of your testimony and, just sharing just how it was. And, I believe, but it goes beyond that. It goes to the fact that we know God draws. And, you know, even the salvation, you know, we hear, you know, Jesus said, I have all those that the Father has drawn unto me. And I believe that the Lord, even like in here this evening, whether it's, in a foreign country or no matter what state of the United States that, you know, we're broadcasting in right now, the Lord draws people. There are people on here tonight that needed to hear what you had to say. The Lord put you here so that you could tell them what they need to hear. And so for all those that are listening, you know, we don't know you. We don't even know where you reside. We don't know where you're at in your life right now. But one thing that we do know is that God's not a respecter of man. He loves each and every one of us exactly the same. You know, and I can prove that. And I can prove that by just one statement. You know, it says God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. So God loved you so much that he sent his son, to die for you. Now, if God loves Roger more than what he loves me, how can he prove that greater love to Roger? What greater gift can he give Roger that he gave each and every one of us, and that's his son, Jesus Christ? So that's my confirmation. God loves each and every one of us exactly the same. But for those that
Jesus says it, you know, here is love. John 5, the first thing that says, here is love, not that we love but God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation and substitute for our sins.
Amen.
And it's remarkable when you stop to think about that. You know, I spent approximately 1 year, and I just talked much about how Israel lived 1 year in the wilderness. God was walking with them through all that hardship, just like he does with us. And the old generation died, so the new generation came out was the people of faith. And I do believe that all the things that each and every one of us, wherever we're at, like you said, whatever country we're in, whatever state we're in, whatever job or occupation we're in, or anything like that, we are walking, and he is walking with us through those times, to make us to be a people of faith.
Amen. Amen, that's right. That's exactly right.
Without faith, it's impossible to please God. It is not our works that please Him, but our faith.
Amen.
Our rewards that we will have in heaven, those things that were done right by the Spirit.
Right.
Because faith is what pleases Him, because He gives it His faith. And says, now, I give you the tools, and I want you to walk out with me. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. In the many decades in prison, I often found myself weeping to the Lord and saying, Lord, how long? How much longer? And I said this to Steve because He didn't really answer me. What He would do is just reveal more of Himself to me. And about a year or two before I leave, I actually, throughout my time walking over and have open vision of things, and I saw the glory of God.
That's right. He says, go out in the highways and the hedges to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, you stop and think about that. You know, I told a lot of people this. I said, you know, He doesn't need us out here driving trucks, working in stamping plants or printing presses or whatever the occupation we might be in. He doesn't need us to do that. That doesn't glorify the kingdom of God, even though when we work for the Lord and we give 110%, that's a form of worship. But what He has us here to do is to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the primary, that is first and foremost, is to go out and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Everything else is secondary. So if we're not doing that, we're pretty worthless, aren't we?
We're not going to find a little. I mean, you see, one of the things I noticed when I got out of prison is that young people are wandering around trying to find a purpose.
Right.
I don't care if they're young or old, middle-aged, and they're trying to find purpose, just like we do. Like I did back in the 70s as a kid, trying to find a purpose and direction in their life. But even more open than now. And the only way you ever find purpose is the one who designed us for His purpose, and that is God. He designed us and put us in the body of Christ as it has pleased Him. He gave us purpose, but now it is our responsibility to figure it out, we'll say not figure it out, but walk with Him, for Him to reveal to us what that purpose is. And until then, you can't be happy. You're not going to really be this right.
That's right.
You can do the drugs, drinking, the sex, even pursue money. I see people pursuing money, but they will not be satisfied without Jesus Christ.
Right, they're not going to fill that void.
They're not.
It's going to keep coming back.
Absolutely. And I say, even as a Christian, you will not find satisfaction in the old flesh anymore.
Right.
You're a Christian. You're a believer of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and your true satisfaction will be walking that relationship out with Him. And there is where you find your divine and your purpose, and He just miraculously opens doors for you to do what He wants and designs you to do. Each of us have our own part. Each of us have our own place.
Amen. That's right. He said, I had a plan for you before you even conceived in your mother's womb.
Come on, Pastor. That's absolutely it. Even before the foundation of the world.
That's right.
He already had a plan for us. Now, your responsibility is to walk with Him to find out what the plan is.
Amen. Amen. You're right. But you know what? You know, you hear a lot of you hear a lot of people say, you know, I know the Lord's got something for me to do, but I'm not sure what it is, so I'm just waiting for Him to reveal it to me. And that kind of bothers me a little bit. Because, for one, we know that He says, go out into the highways and hedges, share the gospel of Jesus Christ. There you go.
Absolutely.
There you go. And it says, yeah, but I'm not sure that I can do that. I'm not sure that I know how to do that. He doesn't call he equips those that He calls.
Absolutely.
And if He calls you to do it, He's going to equip you to do it. He's not going to leave you out there looking like a dummy. You know, he's gonna equip you. And besides that, it says that we can do all things through Christ Jesus that strengthens us.
Absolutely.
So it's just a matter of getting up and going out. And you know, as you know, we have a mutual friend, Bill Fay, and there's something that that he says a lot that sticks with me. When you go up and you're witnessing to a person, and they don't want to hear it. They flat out tell you, you know, yeah, I don't believe it, you're a dummy for believing it, or whatever they might say to you. It's not you they're rejecting. They're rejecting Jesus Christ. So don't be offended by it, because it's going to happen.
Jesus himself said that.
Exactly.
If you don't receive me, it's not you that don't receive the Father.
That's right.
We are, because they don't receive you. It's not that they don't receive you, they don't receive me.
Exactly, exactly.
But that's exactly true. That's because we are not living for ourselves. It's Christ living in us, the little boy.
Right.
We are dead. We are dead, and our life is not hidden in Christ, who is the Lord. So when He comes, we live with Him. So, in the end, we're saying, we're walking dead men. we're in Christ, we're really walking dead people. They're living the resurrection life of God. And that old man is dead. And I'm dead to myself, and I'm continuing every day to die, one more day also, and live for Jesus.
Amen.
It's not a one-time thing. Interesting, but you know, and I know Brother Bill's like this too. One of the things that I use King James like, because the ETH in one of the word gives you the tense of the word.
Right.
That means it's an ongoing believing. It's not a one-time thing. And then just go off and do your own thing.
Right, right.
You know, we have a false narrative that you can just believe in Jesus and go off and live your own life and live how we want. That's the devil's brain too in trouble.
That's right.
And their destiny is hell. So we are to ongoing believe. It's an ongoing preposition. It's an ongoing working. Day by day, hour by hour, step by step.
That's right.
And that's how we find out the purposes of God in our life. You know, it is the relationship. You know, I just know you briefly, but yet internally we feel like we've known each other for a long time.
Right, right. It's because of likeness of mind.
Come on.
We got that likeness, that fellowship.
Yeah, we're learning about each other.
Right.
That's what the relationship is. You know, I mean, Bill Fay, he came to visit me in prison in 1983. That's how long ago it was.
Okay.
And he was a light for me in a very dark time of my life. And he stayed in contact with me all those decades.
Right.
And my relationship with him was only growing more and more, so he's like a father to me in many ways.
Right.
So, you know, Steve, out of all things that we can say in this fellowship that we're having, is relationship. Develop relationships. Everybody in the deepness of their heart really wants good relationships, whether it's with family, whether it's in the brotherhood, or it's just with people. Christ was able to have relationships, and He calls us to have relationships. And I think that's number one.
Amen. Amen. You're right. I agree with you totally on that.
So, in terms of it, you know, we're teaching in our church now about kingdom concepts, and one of the things we're saying is that heaven is just a temporary place. Because we're coming back from heaven to be on the earth here. And it's going to be an eternal relationship. Death doesn't separate us.
Right.
Death is only the passageway into a greater glory.
Right, yeah.
So we have nothing to be afraid of. And I know that there are people in countries right now who are probably listening, and their lives are on the line on a daily basis because of threats against them as believers in Jesus. And, you know, they face a persecution, a hardship. We in America have yet, what I believe is coming, have not yet begun to experience the kind of persecution that some of our listeners, your listeners, that you're listening to right now, are experiencing. And yet, they do it because they believe that Jesus Christ is real and he's alive in them.
That's right.
And that's very important that we acknowledge that they are putting their life on the line for believing. And yet, if they do die, they will be right in the presence of God.
Amen, amen. Was the word saying to die, to live in Christ is, you know, to live in Christ and to die is gain.
Absolutely correct.
Amen.
That's what we really wrote that in Philippians from the prison. Yeah, well,
right.
Waiting death. Waiting death. You know, and so it is a gain. Not that I'm, you can say, suicidal, happy, or anything like that. I mean, but even Paul knew that he could not die until he had fulfilled his course.
That's right. God's in control of it. As we said earlier, that he had planned for you before you even conceived in your mother's womb. He knows all this. This is not a surprise to him. It's not like Jesus is looking at God and saying, wow, why didn't we think of that?
Amen.
He knows.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. But God is good. But for all of you that are listening, wherever you might find yourself this evening, whatever thoughts that you might have in your head as far as how you evaluate yourself and to try to come up with some kind of place of where you determine your value, know this, that again, as we had spoken before, that Jesus come to die for each and every one of us. You know, we all remember John 3:16, you know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. But we got to look at John 3:17, that Jesus came into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world would be saved. When we're talking about the world, we're not talking a geographic location. What we're talking about is you. You as an individual. You are the world that Jesus came to save. He is not, again, he is not a respecter of man. He takes the worst of the worst. And what is the worst? The Bible says if you're a violator of one of the commandments, you're a violator of them all. I know that if I would ask some of you, if you died tonight, where would you go? And I get a lot of responses that, well, I would go to heaven. And I just experienced this the other day, talking to a truck driver, and I says, well, that's great. Why do you think that? And he says, because I'm basically a good person. Well, the Bible says that there's none righteous, no, not one, that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's going to be a lot of so-called good people in hell.
Yes.
Because we are all sinners. But the Word of God also says that even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And this us, again, is each and every one of you that hear me. If you cannot say without, well, let's go back to this being a good person. Have you ever lied? Have you ever stolen anything? Have you ever used God's name in vain? Have you ever lusted after a woman in your heart? Just about each and every one of us could say yes to those. Those are just a few of the Ten Commandments that you've already violated. So how good of a person are you? So being that, so thinking that you're a good person will get you into heaven, you might as well get rid of that thought, because there's only one way to heaven, and that's Jesus Christ. He says, if you'll confess with your mouth, that's to come in agreement with God. If you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You don't have to put on your best clothes. You don't have to go to some big, beautiful church with stained glass windows. You don't have to go find a priest, a pope, a preacher, a deacon, or any of that stuff. All you need to do is just get quiet for a minute and come to that acknowledgement that you are a sinner, and if you die today, you will go to hell. I ain't going to sugarcoat it, because God's not going to sugarcoat it when you stand before him. All you have to do is just say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know I've done some evil and wicked things. And guess what? He already knows you did it. But you say, I've done these evil and wicked things, and I'm asking you to forgive me. And I'm asking you to take control of my life. And show me how to live this life that you want me to live. You don't have to say it word from word like that. If you truly believe that you're in a world of trouble right now outside of Jesus Christ, I don't have to lead you on what to say. You'll know what to say. But I just gave you that as an example, that it's just that simple. There's no big fancy words. You don't have to study for it. You don't have to, you know, seek out the perfect prayer. Just speak from your heart. And as soon as you do that, the Lamb's book of eternal life is opened up and your name is written in the book. You know, if you die, when you die, you're going to hear one of two things. You know, the Bible says, absent from the body, present with the Lord. I mean, it's just as direct as that. Don't think you're going into some purgatory and people are going to pray out and that. That's not in the Bible. It's not biblical. It says, absent from body, present with the Lord. When you stand before him, he's going to say one of two things to you. He's going to say, come in, my good and faithful servant, for you have ran your race. Now, that race isn't measured in length. He knows the plan he has for you. When you stand before him, that's the end of your race. Or you're going to hear, depart from me. You are a doer of iniquity. That's a doer of lawlessness. And I know you not. He only knows those that have called upon the name of Jesus. So I urge each and every one that's listening to me, if you have not made a confession of faith, if you have not asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart and forgive you, this is a decision that you need to make. You know, we look at decisions, Roger. Should I get married? Should I buy a house? Should I have children? Should I buy a car? These are important decisions, and decisions you need to think about. But the most important decision that you can make is a decision for Jesus Christ. And if you're the one that would say, well, I've got time, I'm going to wait, well, no, you just made a decision. You made a decision for the God of this world. The Word of God says that Satan is the God of this world. If you have not made a decision for Jesus Christ, you've made a decision for the enemy. You've made a decision for Satan. And your destiny is right there. You don't know if you're going to wake up in the morning. So I urge each and every one of you again, make that decision, because it's an eternal it's an eternal decision. But pardon me.
Yeah, so you know, so if you confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins.
That's right.
And the word confessor, it doesn't mean I'm telling him something he doesn't know. That's not at all what it means. It means I'm just coming into agreement.
Right.
I have sin in my life, but I'm a sinner. And I agree with it, and I agree that Jesus Christ is the Lord and is the Savior. And I believe it in my heart, and I confess it with my mouth, that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and you shall be saved.
Amen. Amen. Well, brother, we definitely appreciate you spending time with us here this evening. And, you know, sharing your testimony with us. Again, you know, we're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and by the testimony. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I will be getting a hold of you. There's a revival going on, I think, possibly close to where you're at. And I think you really enjoy it. Are you close to, I don't know the areas, I just know where they're at, and I know another friend of mine in Colorado is, you know, the Denver area, he's from there. He's familiar with the area. Have you ever heard of, well, I'm sure you've heard of it, is Greeley close to you?
Greeley?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just local.
Yeah, there's a big revival going on up there this weekend. I'll send you the copy of the flyer. You know, I'll post it to you.
Okay.
Okay. But with that being said, I would like to pray for you before we sign off for the night.
Okay.
Well, Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for another awesome evening. Another evening where we were able to come together and have fellowship. And your word said that iron sharpens iron. And Father, it's an encouragement when we hear how you have transformed, how you delivered, and, you know, Lord, how you reinstated. And Father, we just praise you for that. I pray for my brother and his wife, his son, and his grandchildren. I pray your hedge of protection around them. I pray no hurt or harm will come against them. Father, we know that when we're in the front battles of this war that we're fighting in good against evil, that the battle rages the hottest on the front line. And my brother's on the front line. And the enemy would like nothing more than to silence him. So I pray, Father, as your angels encampeth around him, that, Lord, we know that the enemy can't come in to that encampment. But we know that we can step outside of that. I pray that you give my brother discernment, Lord, that he sees what's going on around him. And, Father, that as you speak to him, that he, I know, that he hears your voice, because you says that the sheep hear the shepherd's voice. And so I know he hears your voice. But I pray your protection around him. I pray that you open doors up to him, Lord. You said that if we call upon you, or call upon you, you'll answer us and show us great and mighty things that we knoweth not. And I think some of these great and mighty things are the doors that you're going to be opening up to him. And I just praise you for that, Lord. I pray for all the drivers running up and down the highways here tonight. And, you know, no matter where you're at, I pray the protection around you. I pray that you bring no harm to anyone in operating them trucks. I pray, Father, that if we're going to change their lives, it's not by running them over, but it's by sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. So, Father, I just praise you for who you are. I praise you, Father God, for drawing us unto the foot of the cross. So, Father God, we just give you all praise. We give you all glory and honor. And we pray this by no other name but the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And with that being said, I'd like to thank again each and every one that has been with us here this evening. I'd like to thank you, Brother Roger, again for coming and sharing with us. And I look forward to doing this again.
Absolutely.
Amen. Amen.